Hello and welcome. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar, Coexistence, Managing Working Lands for Wildlife with Dr. Liesl Erb. My name is Heather Wingert and I'm the Parent and Community Relations Manager. We're excited to have so many of you joining us. Dr. Erb is partnering today with Warren Wilson's land managers, Shawn Swartz, Ben Mackie, and Blair Thompson, who will be joining us at the end of Dr. Erb's presentation to help answer questions. Right now, we want to recognize our leadership, platinum, and gold level sponsors for 2019-2020. Sponsors support our events throughout the year with generous gifts to the college, and we are grateful for their support of today's events and initiatives on campus that forward our mission. If your business is interested in being a sponsor for this upcoming year, we are offering excellent opportunities for marketing and brand exposure in this virtual environment. Please reach out to me using the contact info in the chat box. These opportunities will begin in September. During the presentation, if you wish to ask a question about Dr. Erb's presentation, please submit your question using the Q&A box. You'll find the Q&A box as you hover over your screen with your mouse. I'll be moderating the Q&A throughout the presentation. We will finish the presentation on the hour and stay a few minutes after to answer as many of your questions as we can. My colleagues in advancement will also be monitoring the Q&A. Now, I would like to introduce our co-host of today's webinar, Dr. Dave Ellum. Dave is Dean of Land Resources with over 13 years at the college. He has been paramount in delivering public educational opportunities for the wider community through the Conservation Exchange at Warren Wilson. The Conservation Exchange is developing a model by creating new resources for landowners. And it's reaching out to engage local, national, and international stakeholders in sustainable, economically viable, innovative land stewardship. The Conservation Exchange relies on the applied learning philosophy central to a Warren Wilson education to spread hope and meaningful action against the backdrop of climate change. If you're interested in learning more about the research initiatives, community partnerships and resources for landowners, and public lectures and workshops for sustainable land management, you can use your phone right now to take a picture of the QR code on the bottom of your screen to follow the Conservation Exchange on Facebook. Or you can visit the Land Innovation page on our website and sign up for the Conservation Exchange newsletters. We'll be sure to include a link in the chat box today. And now I would like to turn it over to Dr. Dave Ellum, who will introduce Dr. Erb. Dave?
Thanks, Heather. It's wonderful to be with you all again. I'd like to take a quick moment to just find out who's here with us today. So a poll is going to jump up. And if you all could take a second to just click on yes or no if you've been with us for past seminars. Wow, great, 65% of you have been with us before. Well, that's awesome. So you all know the high quality we put on our educational webinars here. So we plan to offer many more of these in the future. So hopefully you'll join us for those, and you can always get back to any of us if you have any other questions or you want any more information. I'd like to take a quick moment. President Morton is here with us today, and I'd just like to take a quick moment for President Morton to introduce herself and say hello.
Hi, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here with you today. Thank you so much for attending. And I would just tell you that you've made a good decision to come listen to Dr. Erb. I've seen her present before. She's a superb teacher and researcher. We have so many of those here at Warren Wilson College, and we're very fortunate that she's going to talk to us today. And so thank you again for your presence. We're looking forward to hearing from Liesl Erb.
Yeah, I want to second. I work with Liesl, and I want to second what President Morton said. Liesl's great presenter and discussion. Liesl is professor of conservation biology at Warren Wilson College, starting her sixth year in both the biology and the environmental studies department. Liesl is a wildlife biologist with interest in how human-driven changes in landscapes impact wildlife, particularly mammals. Originally from Idaho, Receiving her degrees in Colorado, her research has ranged from the Rocky Mountains to Southeast Asia, where she has used non-invasive survey methods like camera trapping, hair, and scat surveys to find out how animals use wild and human-dominated landscapes. Here in the Southern Appalachians, she works with her conservation biology students to better understand how rare mountain wildlife, such as the Appalachian cottontail and the eastern spotted skunk, are making do in a rapidly changing world, while also exploring how more common species, such as bears, squirrels, and bats, use and even improve working lands, such as farm fields, forests, here at Warren Wilson. Today, she's going to be sharing a bit about what she and her students have found out through these studies. Take it away, Liesl.
Thank you to Dave and President Morton. I hope to not let you down. I am delighted to be here with you all today and to share a little bit about what we do here at Warren Wilson. I want to start from the beginning, and we can go to the next slide, Erica. I'd like to start from the beginning to say that I am not an expert in what we're talking about today, but I'm a big fan. And I love reading about this stuff. I love doing it, but it's not something I do every day. And so I'm excited to share what I know, but also, as with all conservation exchange events, we really see this, and I see this as a chance to exchange information, to talk and chat, and hopefully just the beginning of discussions that we can have about this, particularly in Western North Carolina. I would love to see many folks that are interested in wildlife on working lands get together, and I think we could do some really groundbreaking work across the region if we communicate. So I'm excited to get things started. Again, I'm just gonna talk for 20 minutes or so, and then the folks that do this on the ground work that none of this that I'll talk about today would happen without them, will join us and share their perspective, and then we're happy to answer questions. Next slide. I would love the chance to also know who else is with me. I know who's on the panel. We have another poll for you that's gonna pop up here, if we could get that up. And if folks could just let me know your perspective. Are you here today because you're in conservation, because you're a land manager, maybe you're both, maybe neither, and you were just interested? Also, like, hi, Dad. I know he's gonna be watching. So he might be neither, though he's interested in all of them. So if you could take a minute and answer that, and I'll let you know where we're headed today. So I want to start with some definitions. We need to think about what coexistence is, why we're talking about it right now in 2020, why working lands. Great, thank you for that poll, everybody. Why conservation biologists might be interested in working lands. What's the purpose of thinking about those kinds of lands for conservation? Why land managers might be interested in managing for wildlife as well. What are some of the best practices? And what are some of the things we're doing at Warren Wilson, and what have we learned so far? So that's where we're headed. Next slide, please. So when we think about the word coexistence, and I don't know if, next slide, please. When we think about just starting with some definitions, what is coexistence, that word? Well, if we look at the root of that word, we've got existence at the end of it, which would be to live, and co meaning together. I wanted to take-
Having a little technical difficulties.
Okay, just making sure it wasn't just my internet, which has happened before. But I'm on campus for the record, so. So we can start talking about, so the idea of coexistence, right? Exist, to live, co, together. And there's a lot of debate as this slide comes up, thinking about, as academics do, thinking about those definitions and whether to exist is enough, or do we want these things to thrive? Do we want humans and wildlife to be thriving together in a landscape? We see many examples, we see varying examples of how wildlife and humans might be on a landscape together. Sometimes it might be pretty, they're together on the landscape, but the wildlife is in a national park over here and the humans are in their settlement over here, their town or city. And so that's very different, right? And might be managed differently than if both are using the same landscape every day, day in, day out, that wildlife's walking through the very places where humans are. I'll keep talking and we'll get some slides. It's all good. So unless Erica, you want me to stop, just holler at me, but I'll just keep talking. So the coexistence field in academia and the conservation world is really exploding right now. It's a big hot topic. This is evidenced by the fact that when I just did a quick Google Scholar search of number of articles published just in 2020, so in the last 7 months, there were over 2,700 articles published, all right? So the scientific and conservation communities are talking about this a lot. And that's great. It's very popular. In fact, the first Wildlife Coexistence Summit was held in Montana last fall, hosted by Defenders of Wildlife. There's a new, officially it's a new entity, but the work's been happening for a long time called the Center for Conservation Peacebuilding. They're all about trying to find those peaceful solutions, particularly in the case of carnivores in livestock, in livestock lands, for example. So this is a burgeoning world, and it's exciting that new work to benefit wildlife and humans is happening. But it's important, I want to acknowledge that modern coexistence movement, this new push, is rooted in conflict. Basically, it's seen as a response to expanding human populations, shrinking wildlands, and the conflict we see between those two, between wildlife and humans when that happens. And I want to acknowledge and own that in the US, that culture of conflict, of humans versus nature, it originates from a colonial mindset that was brought in from Europe. And this is really important to acknowledge, that when settlers came to North America from Europe, they brought with them, many of them brought with them the view that humans exist separate from nature, and that nature consists of resources that can be extracted and controlled and used for human purposes. And that spurred exploration and homesteading on what was dubbed the wild frontier. I'm seeing, okay, so our slides froze. I'm just gonna keep talking. it was dubbed the wild frontier, right? And eventually we'll get some slides and I'll show you. I put in some pictures of my own ancestors, my Scandinavian ancestors that settled in Northern Idaho. They cut timber, they farmed, they claimed the land as their own via the Homesteaders Act. And I wanna say that those folks loved the land. They also loved the resources they could extract from it. And I appreciate and love them for the connection to land that they gave me that was passed through the generations. But it's really important also just in my own personal journey, and I think for many of us in conservation, to realize that the actions that were taken by European ancestors on this continent they've carried attitudes and along with them to their descendants, and they've had long-lasting consequences. So those actions have had consequences on people as well as places that we're all interacting with today. And so I wanna own that and acknowledge it. And with that, it's important to note that not everyone's ancestors had those views of kind of domination and control of natural resources. I'm sitting in my office at Warren Wilson, and I'm on lands that were stewarded by ancestors of the Eastern Band of the Cherokee Indians for thousands of years. The humans who originally lived here, they did work the land. We know they managed forests and cultivated crops, but they did so with a very different mindset and view of humans' role in natural ecosystems. Perfect, Erica, that's where we want to be. And I want to bring that up for a few reasons, but the one I'm going to highlight right now is just that coexistence isn't new, right? If you look at the scientific literature, there are 2,700 articles, and it's as if this is a brand new idea, and it's not. It's just one that hasn't been the dominant narrative in the United States in recent centuries, and we need to elevate that narrative again. And so that's part of our hope in doing this work. for the better of our ecosystems and all the people that are on this planet. So with that, next slide, we're back. So as we move forward with the goal of a sustainable coexistence movement and all the definitions of sustainability, it's critical that conservation and land managers have buy-in too. And those stakeholders might have different reasons for engaging in this kind of work. We have to ask ourselves, why would conservationists care about working lands? Why don't they mostly just work in national parks, right? Or why would land managers care about wildlife? They've got enough to deal with and manage, right? Next slide, please. So why should conservationists care about working lands? Well, there are a few reasons, and they're actually rooted in what I just was talking about the roots of conservation and resource extraction in the modern US society. And that is that idea of humans versus nature manifested it such that people said, well, we need to set up national parks. And don't get me wrong, I am such a fan of the national park system. The US did some amazing things in starting those national parks, but we also did some not so amazing things. We, meaning the folks in power at the time, including saying that no humans should be in those parks. And so we set up national parks, and you can see that wild frontier I was talking about. You can see where most of the parks were created are in the Western US, right? And there are very few of those preserves here. If we look at those preserves today, and I wanna point out that this is a variety of land management that we see here. And so some of it's Bureau of Land Management, which will have different conservation approaches to say a national park, but still there's a whole lot, like in my home state of Idaho, right? Huge wilderness areas, not so much in the East. If we only focus on preserves and reserves for wildlife and other biodiversity, we're missing out, I would argue. And I highly respect E.O. Wilson. He's an amazing scientist and conservation mind, but he's really gone all in on this preservation kind of approach. His half-earth approach says that we need to set aside half of the world's biodiversity, half of the world's land in order to save biodiversity. And the reality is we've only saved 17%. There's only 17 of it in preserves. But many, and I'll admit, including myself, question how on earth we're gonna get from 17 to 50 without some serious questions around social justice, questions around where we would put such preserves, right? So there's a lot. My training, I did some training at the Smithsonian early in my career, and I was trained in what we call gray area conservation. It's actually gray on this map. I was very excited when I found this map. And that is not just the black and white of here where preserves where wildlife goes and here are the cities where humans are, but what about the lands in between? And can we do meaningful conservation work in those areas in between? Next slide, please. And here in North Carolina, and if you could click one more time, Erica, we see that there's another really good reason to be thinking about working lands. If we just focused on preserves, formal preserves in North Carolina, that's only 9% of the land of North Carolina, and 78% of North Carolina's land is either in private forests or farms. That's a huge opportunity if we see it as a place we can protect wildlife. Next slide, please. So why should conservationists care? Well, there's a lot of land, first of all. And also this land is already managed for natural resources to some degree, varying depending on the management approaches and practices, but they're not parking lots, right? There's still connection to natural systems in these forests and farms. And so there's great opportunity there. Next slide, we'll think about why land managers should care. There are many reasons. I want to point out that everything I'm saying today, there are like a zillion papers I could lift up and graphs and things. I didn't want to do that for you all today in 20 minutes, but I'm happy to share any of the resources that back up what I'm talking about today. I'll share my email at the end. Reasons to care, conflict avoidance. Again, I mentioned that a lot of the current move toward coexistence is rooted in the fact that there's a lot of conflict going on between wolves and livestock or any number of other examples like that. And so the goal of reducing predation in your system, reducing herbivory in croplands, reducing competition. There's concern around here with elk getting into fields and eating like maniacs. And so that's an important reason to do it. But there are so many other reasons that aren't rooted in that conflict attitude, not the least of which is ecosystem services. There are so many wildlife species that will do amazing things for our working lands if we just let them. Pest control, their natural, you know, birds of prey that can take care of a lot of our pests for us, for example, bats and similarly, pollinators, of course. And the last thing I want to highlight today is the idea that actually we can diversify revenue streams for working landowners because agritourism and ecotourism are huge, right? And those having those alternate revenue streams, particularly in very uncertain economic times, is really, really valuable. And so that there are many, those are many of the reasons that we might do this. And I want to just point out this graphic, what it is showing. This is from a scientific study that showed that just giving a little bit of help to the wildlife that you want to do some of those ecosystem services for you can pay off in spades later. We see numbers in the billions of dollars that farmers and other managers save in pest control, for example, if they encourage bats and birds to do some of that and bees to do that for them. Next slide, please. So what are some of the best management practices that we know? This is going to be a quick overview, but basically, when in doubt, if you manage with ecology and animal behavior in mind, you're probably thinking in the right direction. Make habitat for them, right? If you build it, they will come. Make nest boxes for bees, birds, bats. Model natural systems, holistic livestock management models, herding behavior that can help with not only biogeochemical cycling in the soil, but also predation risk because of that herd, that herding approach. Similarly, we can focus on non-timber forest products and allow the natural canopy structure to be in a forest and garner resources from it. We can have native deterrents to pests like this, the parasitoid wasps that have laid eggs on this hornworm caterpillar, or have non-lethal deterrents like a guard dog, or as I'll talk about in a minute, a guard donkey to discourage predation. Actually, studies have shown that lethal means to reducing predation don't work in the long term nearly as well as non-lethal deterrents. There are myths out there among ranchers from where I'm from that if you shoot one coyote, six spring up in its place. Obviously, the biology of that is a little is questionable, but there is something to be said for the fact that those lethal approaches are not as effective as deterrence. And studies have shown that over and over. So that's important. Next slide. Maintaining edge habitat, don't just mow that. Let the flowers grow, right? Let the berry bushes grow, and that will encourage those beneficial wildlife species to be there. Maintaining those riparian buffers, not just at the minimum setback, but be generous. And maintaining other food sources for these wildlife species. Next slide. So here at Warren Wilson, we try to employ a lot of these things. We build with my students and Sean and Ben and Blair with their students, we all work hard to implement these things. We build and install bat boxes. We collect non-timber forest products that will allow us to use our forests in multiple ways that might be wildlife friendly. We're restoring our riparian areas. We maintain edges like this goldfinch is appreciating in the chicory there. And it has paid off. We get some certifications through like certified wildlife habitat. We're a Monarch Way Station. We're a Bee Campus USA among many others that our existing land managers and hardworking folks in our landscaping crews in the past have done. So next slide. And the thing is, we're a sample size of one, right? And this is part of why I'm talking to you all today, because we're a sample size of one. We can do studies, and I'll show you some of the studies we've done, but in the end, we are one piece of land. And so I'm excited about the potential if anyone out there is interested in joining and partnering so that we can ask some of these questions across multiple landscapes. It would be really helpful, but I can share some of what we've found. We have some anecdotal stuff, starting with Lola, the fantastic donkey. She is our guard donkey. She guards our sheep. We have a couple of sheep herds here. Actually, this is one of our fiber sheep, so it's a little misleading, but she was so charismatic, I wanted to show a picture of her. But we also have the sheep we manage for lamb production, and Lola guards them. Well, we had it's a long story, but there was a moment in time a couple summers ago when Lola wasn't with the sheep. And unfortunately, within just a few days, we lost several lambs, which is striking. So it's a sample size of one, but it's striking. And when these were reunited, Lola and her sheep, we have not had the casualties since. When my students deployed some cameras to figure out who was afoot in these pastures, it was coyotes. We do have quite a large coyote population here, but we're able to coexist as long as Lola steps in, right? So realizing that some of those non-lethal means can be really useful. Next slide, please. My students have done a lot of research looking using, as Dave said, I really like to use non-invasive methods for surveying wildlife. And so we've used camera traps a great deal across our forest. I've had two great students among many others, but I'll highlight these two today. Chad Fierros and Anna Lindsay both did camera trapping projects on our lands. Next slide, please. And so they looked at four different of our forest compartments, many of which abut our farmlands, and they set cameras right at the edge of the farmland and then into the interior of the forest to get a good sense of all the habitat types and how wildlife was using it. Next slide. And we found a total of 13 mammal species. But what was most interesting to me, and some birds, if you can see, those are two pileated woodpeckers having a conversation or something in the middle. But what's notable here is that the six species were found at all of those sites. But in fact, if we hadn't surveyed all those sites and we hadn't had those different forest compartments, which Shawn can talk about, we manage in different ways with different goals. If we hadn't had that diversity of landscape, we wouldn't have captured the full diversity of wildlife. So part of it is maintaining a mosaic of habitats that can be really important. I'm always telling my conservation students, diversity begets diversity. And if you have diversity of habitats, you'll have diversity of wildlife. Next slide, please. The other thing we're really excited about here on campus is bats. As I mentioned, bats' benefit to farmers is measured in the trillion dollars globally. They can eat pounds and pounds of insects in a night. It's amazing. And so we monitor bats here on campus in a few ways. We partner with Indiana State University and the North Carolina Wildlife Resources Commission to monitor them through acoustic monitoring, which is what you see in those bottom two pictures, and also some live capture so that we can get our hands on them and know who's who and what sex they are, how their weight is, all of that, and tag them to track them a little bit. And next slide. I've had a few students work on bats. The student I'm going to highlight today is Elsa Klein. She did great work doing acoustic monitoring of bats in several places around campus. Next slide, please. And she found some really cool stuff. This is a list of all the bat species in North Carolina. And if the row is colored, that means that we've detected it here on campus, which is really exciting in and of itself. We got a lot of bat species. And what we found is that Some of them were common, those are in green here, and those that are in warmer tones are all imperiled in some way. We're worried about them either at the state or federal level. Our big boon, the most exciting thing, was that we found the endangered gray bat on campus, and it didn't just fly through once, it loves it here. It spends a lot of time here. And this is just thrilling and so exciting. And I have to say, we need to do more research on this, but I have to say that there are lots of things in our management practices that tell me that we're doing it right for the bats and for other wildlife. A bat is a complex animal that needs a lot of different types of habitat. It needs habitat to roost in. It needs high quality, clean water that insects can emerge from so that it can feed. It needs low to no pesticide adjacent lands, again, for insect purposes. And so this is an example of our farm and garden and forest management practices all coalescing to allow us to be habitat for an endangered species. And that is what it's all about, at least for me. Next slide, please. So that's an overview. It's been really quick, but I want to be sure we hear from our managers today. We can go ahead and go to the next slide. As I said, I'm really excited for this to be the beginning of a longer conversation, not just with the remaining half hour that we have, but also here's my email address. It's lerb, that's an L. So lerb@warrenwilson.edu. And I would love, truly, if anyone out there is interested in collaborating on this kind of work, I'd love to talk more. So with that, I'll turn it back over to folks and we'll check in with the managers. I'd love for the managers to share their perspectives.
Okay, so now we'll have all the managers, Shawn, Ben, and Blair, give you an opportunity to each turn on your videos and do an introduction for our attendees about your role on campus and about any academic research projects that might be associated with your working landscape goals here on campus.
Do you want any of us in particular? Should I just start?
That's great.
Okay.
Go for it, Shawn.
I'm Shawn Swartz. I'm the forest manager here. And see what I can say in terms of our management and how it relates to this. You know, one of our recent graduates was the Southern Appalachian Forest Stewards Guild Regional Director of foresters that focus their management on ecological forestry. And he left that recently for a position with the Ruffed Grouse and American Woodcock Society as their Southern Appalachian Forest Conservation Director. And that sounds like it's a jump, you know, from forestry to wildlife and a little bit of a non sequitur there, but it's actually not at all, because when you're managing for wildlife, in some cases, you might be managing directly with that species, such as how we restore the American condor. But by and large, when you're doing management for wildlife, you're managing for habitat. And so as foresters, what we can do is manage for habitat that benefit a variety of species and for wildlife. So we actually did, as a crew, for about 9 years, do some service work with the North Carolina Wildlife Resource Commission for their North Carolina Acoustic Survey for bats. And, but, you know, I don't really know a lot about bats individually, but, you know, I'm really excited that we have a threatened and endangered species on our campus. And I know that we have that not because I know anything specific about bats, but what I do know is that managing for riparian corridors is really good forest management, and that's where we found, you know, our bats. So managing for riparian corridors is achieves multiple objectives: water quality, recreation, but in this case it benefited, you know, a threatened and endangered species of wildlife. So we have managed for structural diversity, meaning creating through harvesting activities and other kinds of silviculture activities, creating different layers in the forest, you know, so that we have mid-story available in some places and overstory available in other places. Managing for water, you know, putting in ponds or retention areas that can attract certain kinds of wildlife. We manage for a variety of ages, different successional stages in the forest. And because some species of wildlife prefer early succession habitat, whereas some prefer later succession. And by succession, I just mean kind of older, how the evolution of the forest happens once it's gone through a disturbance. And some species need a variety. So we don't manage for specific species as much as trying to ensure that we have these varieties of habitats and varieties of successional stages that are going to benefit a suite of species. And so that's kind of how we approach it with our forest management and with the forestry crew is by creating habitat.
Great, thank you so much, Shawn. Mm-hmm. We'll lead next with Ben and then followed by Blair, just introducing your role here on campus. And then we have a couple questions that have come in and we'll start to do those questions next.
Thank you. Yes, my name is Ben Mackie. I am the garden manager here at Warren Wilson. And so I oversee the vegetable production as well as the medicinal herbs, the bee crew and the horse crew. And so all of that is kind of a broad, broad spectrum of different parts of our production. And the way that we address this wildlands management is more for the invertebrates. We are certainly promoting bird and bat habitat. We have a beautiful bat hotel that one of Liesl's classes put up right next to the garden cabin. And the birds and the bats are a major contributor to attacking the different insects that attack our vegetables. And then another major thing that we do is for the invertebrates. So we're trying to promote a lot of those predatory wasps as well that we saw in that picture on the tomato hornworm. And so we see that. And then we're also trying to promote the larger invertebrates that have seen a major decline in the last couple decades. Like the mantises that we've seen, we've been really, every mantis sac we find is a major resource. And so when I got here 4.5 years ago, we started collecting all those and trying to give them the best habitat that we can. And we've seen a huge bump up in all of the mantises that we see around campus and in our lands in particular. So we found, first year we found like 2 or 3, and then last winter we found over 20. And so we're just seeing that major increase just in those little management techniques that we can do that then they will be the major predator on some of our pests in the vegetable gardens. So we also try and leave a lot of the headlands or like the edges that Liesl was talking about to then promote more habitat for the invertebrates and also a lot of flowering species because a lot of flowering cover crops and flowering different herbs because the predatory wasps that laid those eggs on the tomato hornworm, all of those really like those flowering herb species that like dill and fennel and the really odoriferous ones. And so we just try and get as much diverse habitat for those species as possible all around our areas. So we have fields all over campus and we try and promote that as much as possible.
That's great. Thanks, Ben. And now we have Blair Thompson, farm manager.
Hi, yeah, I'm Blair Thompson. I'm the farm manager here at Warren Wilson. I'm also the short timer. I've only been here since January. So I'm still learning the landscape and learning about the research that we're engaged in on it. One of the things I really appreciate about what Liesl was saying, though, is that these things they can't just be conceptual. They really have to work in order to be adopted by particularly livestock managers and land managers. They want to see results because their economic bottom line depends on it. And I often, when I'm thinking about these things, I remember as a younger person reading Barry Lopez's Wolves and Men. And one of the things he talks about is the dance of death, that he contends that we're bred out of domesticated stock, that wild stock, the reason they aren't aggressively predated in the same way that domesticated stock is because they still know how to interact with wolves. And that I remember feeling really compelling to me when I was younger. And as I've moved deeper into my career and working with livestock, I've really come to believe the opposite, that the problem isn't the stock, the problem is the manager. And that we really need to be focused on empowering our animals to coexist in these wild lands and in these wild spaces, and not interacting with them and not setting them up in situations where the behaviors they're prepared to exhibit because of, you know, they are a prey species, aren't sort of worked out of them because of how we've interacted with them. So that's something, you know, we really emphasize, is those low stress handling techniques and trying to emphasize and bring out the behaviors that are inherent in these animals is not just so it's easy for us to move them around. It's also that then when they are confronted with actual predators and not just their human handlers, they're prepared to meet those situations. And I think ways like that, where you, if you can explain it in a way that's like, hey, you're going to win these battles, to put it in a confrontational way with these prey more, if you interact with your stock in a way that sets them up for success when they have those interactions, is something that I think is really important for land managers to think about, and something that, you know, I think Liesl did a really nice job of speaking to, letting them herd, letting them look for their offspring and for their young, and introducing other species into those herds that, you know, will be able to give them some natural resistance to these predator species that are coming in on them. And so that's something we'll definitely be continuing to work with and try to build up in our operation.
Great, thanks, Blair. So we have a few questions that have come in, and the first one, we're gonna kick it off with Liesl. Liesl, the question is related to knowing more about strategies for coexisting with wildlife and managing at-risk botanicals, such as wild simulated and wild American ginseng. I'm just curious about strategies that you would recommend.
Yeah, to be honest, this is a good example of something where the on-the-ground knowledge will be more useful, because that is something that Shawn deals with on a regular basis. So I may knock it over to him, just because he does that practical. He has to defend his ginseng here on campus. We won't tell anyone where it is, but it's here. So Shawn, what is your perspective on that? I know we do have deer issues that are growing, the population's growing by the day, and it's something we're gonna have to think about. What is your thought?
Sure. I have not noticed any pressure from deer on any of our ginseng yet. We have had issues. We're also growing black Perigord truffle on hazelnut, and those trees are quite expensive because of the inoculation process that they go through. And we lost quite a bit of those to deer, probably to some voles as well. But we put some game cameras up and have tracked quite a bit of deer in our shrub species that we're growing. They're putting quite a bit of pressure on there. And I think that, you know, the farm and garden, or at least the garden in particular, is going to see a greater increase of deer as we've tracked this increase of density. They weren't present here about a decade ago, and they're really starting to get established. We, with our game cameras, have mostly identified that they're nocturnal for the most part. Normal ways of trying to control the population through reducing the herd, it isn't really going to work if they're nocturnal. I'm thinking that we're probably going to have to rely more on coyote to manage them, but that's also going to possibly increase, you know, some of the pressure on our livestock as well. So, you know, it's a balancing act. that we have to go to, in some of our situations where deer is really heavily pressured, we probably have to just go to fencing. And the fencing that is used to keep deer out is extensive. You know, it's either a double row of 4-foot fencing or it's an 8-foot fence, you know, that they're pretty persistent. So that's the thoughts that I have initially on it. I don't know that ginseng isn't a preferred food for deer, as the question might have indicated, where if they have other habitat, they'll leave it alone. I think they probably actually know what some of the medicinal qualities are of the ginseng and are using it in the same way that we do. I can say lastly, and I'll be quiet, it has been discovered through research that when deer eat the ginseng berries, the seeds are not viable anymore when they pass through their digestive system. There is a species of wood thrush that has been identified, but they've been looking for a long time for what wildlife species can actually help move ginseng around. And it was just recently discovered that wood thrush regurgitates the seed within 15 to 20 minutes of eating it. And so it doesn't destroy the seed in its digestive process. And so again, managing for ginseng, you're managing for habitat of wood thrush so that you can get the ginseng genetics spread throughout the landscape.
All right, so this next one is for you, Liesl. It's related to, explain a little bit more about what an ecometer touch is and how does it detect, identify different species of bats?
That's a great question, and it's good I'm in my office, I have my props. So you saw in those slides, there was a contraption that a man was setting up by the river that was a big box with a lot of stuff in it. That is very expensive equipment, acoustic equipment that does a really good job with bat identification. But there is a company, this is not an ad, it's just, but that Wildlife Acoustics makes this little contraption that plugs into a cell phone, into a smartphone or a tablet. And what it does, that the bugger with bats is that their calls are mostly ultrasonic. They're above what the human ear can hear. And that therefore what what a typical phone is set up to hear. And so what it does is it picks up the ultrasonic calls and then it's able to compare those to a database. And on your phone, you download an app and you download the app for, and you download the list for North Carolina bats, for example, and then it'll compare the calls that it hears to that database and say, I think you've got a gray bat. I think you've got any number of, so it tells you, and it gives you a few options, and there are some details where to really be certain of what you have, you need to do some fancier software. But these are amazing. Bats are so poorly understood and misunderstood. A lot of people are scared of them. A lot of people think rabies. If you're thinking rabies, it's the raccoons, people. Don't take it out on the raccoons either. But just so you know, raccoons are way bigger threat. Also, bats will not get caught in your hair. That's a myth. And this, what's the coolest thing about it is when it identifies the bat, it pops up with a picture in it of it. And that, they have found, has benefits kind of like birding, where the more you get to know the bats and get to know it, people care about them more. That's a classic quote by many folks through the years. Jane Goodall is sometimes attributed to it, but I think it went before her, that in order to save something, you have to care, and to care, you have to know it at all. And so to just get to know bats helps us conserve them. So it's a little device. It's like $200. We have a set of them. I use them with my classes. That was a long answer, but I really love bats. So there's my.
Thanks, Liesl. This next one is for Ben. Ben, do you have any mantis habitat infographics or simple ways for gardeners to learn how they can help them?
Sure. The step one is not using insecticides. That is the major reason for their decline nationally. And they can live on a really diverse set of habitats. They aren't very picky, but they also don't move very far. Once they're fully mature after like 5 or 7 molts, they are able to fly, but that takes almost a full season to happen. And they can live like up to a year if the winters aren't too hard, and that female can lay a couple different egg sacs through that time. But it's a hard one to just encourage because of that travel limitation. So you can buy eggs from different insect purveyors on the internet, which I've never done, but certainly would be fun. And they often, those sacks will have anywhere from like 15 to 200 little baby mantises that are about this big that will end up, you know, a full size. So insecticides are the reason for their decline. And if you do find a sack, just treat it nicely. They look like styrofoam. They're usually about this big on something upright, usually a stem of a tree or a shrub, but can be anything from, I found one on, you know, a piece of wire or a railing this year. So it can be in a lot of different places. And the reason that we love to promote them so much is that they're such good predators. They're, I think they have like an 85% predation success rate. And so they're able to take out a lot of different bugs all in one season. So, yeah.
We have a question here asking about the name of the tool for bat song ID, what that's called.
Yeah, so it's called the Echo Meter Touch. Let's see, I don't know if you can see it if I'm talking. Is it backwards? It's backwards in my camera, but can y'all see that? The Echo Meter Touch. If you want, you can also email me and I can give you more information. It's again, lurb@warrenwilson.com. But yeah, it's from a company called Wildlife Acoustics, and they make them for both Android and Apple products. Again, I sound like I'm advertising. I'm not. They're just really fun.
And then it might be interesting just to hear from you all, just to talk a little bit more about the importance of edge habitat.
I can start and let you guys chime in, but from a wildlife standpoint, hopefully folks know what we mean by edge. It's basically where the domains of these three guys meet, right? So kind of where there's a transition between habitats. And as I said earlier, diversity begets diversity, and an edge habitat can allow for different species to live that wouldn't live in either the interior forest or out in a pasture or in a grassland. And so it's a different habitat. That's part of why it's useful. And we often see particular species that capitalize there. Now, sometimes those species are the species we're, depending on what we're talking about, sometimes edge species are very, are the generalists that we get to know, like raccoons and opossums, but there are other things as well because they provide that unique habitat that transitions between the two. So there are lots of bird species and small mammals that specialize in those areas. I'll let Shawn and Ben talk about, and maybe Blair, whoever feels like chiming in about their perspective on edge.
Yeah, the edge is where the majority of our beneficial wildlife do live there. It's the most ecologically diverse part of any landscape. And so that is where both the songbirds that are taking out smaller insects, as well as the birds of prey that we can just watch swoop down and take out the mole that was devouring our carrots, that's where it will be able to do its job. And so it is a really vital place, and a place that sometimes people, it's not always a valued area. Certainly economically, but ecologically, it is the most valuable area.
I mean, I would only be echoing what's already been said, is that it is a place that some species only use, and then, you know, other species use a variety of habitats, and so that transition area is vitally important. You know, agroforestry wise, it's interesting that, you know, some of the human benefits could really be utilized in the edge areas as well. And some people are doing some research on that now, such as up at Virginia Tech, where you create what's called a stadium effect, you know, like stadium seating. So a lot of our edges on campus right now are abrupt transitions where you go from field to forest. And those environments are also some of the environments that can have some of the biggest issues with invasive species because of the disturbance that that creates. And so they can require a lot of management to provide great functions. But if those edges were planted with shrubs and mid-story species and managed so that the edges were a little more like this, you could do that with species that are edible to humans, hazelnuts. You could grow pawpaw in those areas. You could grow elderberry, you know, and then in this situation, you're providing a human benefit as well as creating habitat that's extremely beneficial for wildlife, because it has been shown over and over that the greatest biodiversity of a species occurs in that edge habitat more than any other. But all are needed. Early succession is needed. Interior intact forest is needed. It's all about providing the full range of those habitats in the landscape.
All right, so I've got a question here either for Ben or Blair. For years, it seems like groundhogs have antagonized many aspects of the agricultural systems on campus. And aside from fencing, are you familiar with any ways that they might coexist?
I don't have a great answer for you, Grace. I mean, you know, I've dealt in different environments with, you know, small mammals that have wreaked havoc in agricultural spaces, and particularly in the West, where I've most recently come from, ground squirrels are a huge issue. And so, you know, the best you can do, I think, in those situations is courage predation. Unfortunately for us, what's, I think, a fairly common predator of groundhogs is coyotes. And so it just raises another set of issues. But yeah, I it's obviously an issue, and unfortunately I don't have a fantastic solution. Ben, you might have more experience with this than I.
Certainly more experience, but not more input. They are a major predator they're a major consumer of our vegetables, I should say. And it being a college campus, there are no firearms allowed. And so over the last, 100 years, they've just been able to really entrench themselves, and they have some pretty substantial communities on campus that are a challenge. And it's just something that, you know, coexisting with. And we do a field rotation, and certainly when we get back to a field that's been either in cover crop or fallow for a significant amount of time, there's a population that we need to coexist with in those fields. So I don't have a great management plan for anything to say that could take care of them easily besides that natural predation and trying to grow things in different areas to kind of coexist with them. So
that's great. So we're actually up on the hour. We have a couple more questions that we'd like to take, but we just wanted to thank everyone for being a part of the webinar today, having Liesl, Ben, Blair, and Shawn to be a part of answering questions. So if you have to go, we hope to see you in the next couple of weeks. We're going to be sending out information about our upcoming webinar coming out soon. But I'm going to go jump into these remaining questions before we wrap up. And this question is primarily for Ben again. Is there any tips or success in managing bee operation and those challenges?
Yeah, bees are having a tough time with it, guys. I don't know if you've heard, but our colonies have been pretty good. Two winters ago, nationally, we lost 40% of bees Those are cultivated European honeybees. And so the cultivated honeybee is, you know, has a lot of pests and problems and just issues with them not being native and us overbreeding them and breeding them for different purposes rather than survival. And so my twist on that would be to promote native bee habitat, because a lot of those mason bees or squash bees, or, you know, there's 400 different native bees in North Carolina, and they can do a lot of that pollination in conditions that honeybees can't do. You know, honeybees are only flying when it's over 70 and not raining and all these things that a native bee, which are generally solitary, there are some bumblebees that create small seasonal colonies, but those are generally solitary bees that are doing their own thing, and they will go out and pollinate every squash flower on a rainy 60 degree day, whereas all the honeybees are inside eating the resources. So honeybees, you definitely need to promote habitat, and again, stop spraying insecticides, but also promoting those native pollinators that don't need as much assistance or cultivation, that can do a lot of that heavy lifting that the European honeybee is not suited for.
Great, thank you. And then the last question is one about our meat sale. Will we be holding it in the fall? Do you all know maybe the answer to that one?
We are 80% sure there's going to be one. Still waiting for some final answers on that, and hope to be in communication through our meat sales email list and, you know, social media posts very soon. Just still trying to work around the uncertainty that we're all dealing with, and the reason we're on a virtual call and not seeing you live. So.
All right, so we are about to conclude our webinar, and we want to share with you a slide that just shows our upcoming webinar by Dr. Hoovy. That'll be happening in 2 weeks from now on Thursday, August 13th, which is about using experimental gardens and citizen science to respond to climate change. So that'll be coming up in 2 weeks, and you can register using the QR code that's in the corner of your screen to take a picture of it, or you can look in the chat box and we'll put a link there as well. So I wanna thank again, Dr. Erb, Blair, Shawn, and Ben for being a part of the call. And we look forward to seeing you in a couple weeks.